Good morning, Parkwood family and friends. Trust that you're doing well this morning and looking forward to worshiping our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We want to start this service off by wishing each of you a happy Easter, a happy Resurrection Sunday, and what a joy it is in our hearts to be able to say that with full assurance that we do serve a risen Savior. We trust that you're with your family, that all is well, and your heart and mind is clear as we prepare to worship Him today, this Easter Sunday. It's going to be a little different today than has been the past few weeks, and got some changes, some good changes to be made. We've got a couple of extra specials today, a couple extra people here with us as we're recording this. But we're going to start out like we would on a normal Sunday, worshiping together with a congregational hymn this Easter morning. And so Brother Ken is here with us. He'll lead us in this congregational hymn, and then he'll follow that with our first special this Sunday morning. We love you. We're praying for you. You worship with the Lord Jesus today there with your family. Brother Ken.
All right. Good morning. We'll sing page 220. He Lives, the first and last verse of page 220. I'm sure you don't have a congregational book at home, but you know the words anyway. Let's sing page 220, He Lives.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, as Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my stairway.
Thank you.
was a blessing to you there. Listen to that, to our family this morning. Trust and pray that that spoke to your heart as it did ours here. Let me just make a couple of announcements and remind you of a couple of things, then we'll move forward in our service this morning. Keep in mind the office is still closed right now. It'll be that way until further notice. Now, if you need anything from the church office, reach out to me. If you need something urgent, reach out to me. If it's something that can wait, you want to get Miss Monica's expertise or something like that, shoot her an email and she'll get back to you when she can. And so keep that in mind. I would encourage you to continue to be faithful in your giving. And we've got multiple ways set up for you to be able to give your tithes, your faith promise, whatever offerings you want to give. You can do that online. Very simple, just go to our website. There's an online giving tab, and it's pretty self-explanatory from there. You can mail checks to the church's P.O. box. That address is listed on our website as well, and in our latest update. If you can't find that, reach out to me, and I'll get that to you. And then certainly, maybe the easiest way is to just set up automatic bill pay with your bank and have a check mailed straight to the church from your bank. But many of you have given. Our offerings have been really good, and so I'm grateful for that. That brings a lot of burden and a lot of stress off of me, and so I'm very, very appreciative for that, and I trust that you'll continue to. We've got a couple of birthdays that we missed last week, and I apologize for that. We won't sing happy birthday to you, but we do want to make you aware of some birthdays. Two of them that happened on April the 9th. Brother Anthony Moore had a birthday on April the 9th, and so if you get a chance, reach out to Anthony and tell him happy late birthday. Then Miss Debbie Parkins had a birthday on April 9th as well, and you need to reach out to Miss Debbie and tell her happy birthday. You know, she has to put up with a whole lot from Brother Tom, and so let's make that birthday well worth it. And then we had an anniversary on April the 2nd, Brother Carl and Miss Tracy Zabrowski had a wedding anniversary, and so we wish them a happy anniversary, happy late anniversary as well. All right, I don't know of any other announcements that are pressing. If some come up, then I'll get to you in just a minute. But we've got a real treat here right now. We've got a singer in our church making his debut, and he is not quite a year old. He's going to be a special musician and a special singer. All right, but Mark Smith and Ryan are going to sing now. And by the way, Miss Joni Smith has been playing the piano for us, and so we're appreciative for that. But Mark, you and Ryan, come on.
Oh, that's it. Now you
great job. What a tremendous song. Two tremendous specials this morning. I know that was a blessing to you.
Amen.
And your family, as it was to me. Take your Bibles this Easter morning and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I know that a lot is changing in our world. Certainly this isn't how we would prefer to be celebrating Easter with you. You know, we serve a God who doesn't change. Doesn't change. He's the same God that he was yesterday, today, and forever. And that brings a lot of comfort to my heart. And, you know, it's always a special, special day of worship when you realize that you serve a risen Savior. And so it doesn't matter where church is for you. It may be in your living room. It may be in your bedroom. Maybe you're watching it on a back porch or a back patio, but nonetheless, you can worship your risen Lord and Savior today because he is alive. He lives forevermore. In his book, I read this book recently, in his book entitled The Darkness and the Dawn, Chuck Swindoll details and describes the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ in that book. And in that book, he tells his story about a man by the name of Ed. Ed was an older man. He had sea bleached. He always wore a sea bleached, a weather-beaten hat on top of his head. And he had somewhat of a very odd habit a weekly habit that he grew accustomed to doing every week. What it was every Friday night, Ed would, just as regular as clockwork, just as the sun would begin to set, Ed would come strolling out of his beach house along the sidewalk there at the beach. He'd make his way to his favorite pier. In his old, beaten, leathery hands, he had a bucket full of shrimp, raw shrimp. Ed would walk out to the end of his favorite pier, and where it seemed like he just had the whole world to himself. The sun was getting low. Most of the beachgoers were gone at this point, and it just seemed like Ed would be standing there alone. Just he himself, his thoughts, and his bucket of shrimp. But before long, though, Ed wouldn't be by himself at all. Up in the sky, before long, would be hundreds and thousands of white dots just darting here and there, squawking and flapping their wings toward that long, skinny old man standing at the end of that pier. And in just a few minutes, dozens of seagulls would surround Ed, and they would flutter, they'd flap their wings, and Ed would stand there on that pier, and he would take his hand in his bucket of shrimp, grab a handful, throw it up in the sky to feed those hungry birds. And if you were there with Ed, and you were listening real closely, Dr. Swindoll says you'd hear him saying with a smile on his face, "Thank you, thank you, thank you." In a few minutes, shrimp would be gone, the bucket would be empty, Ed would hang around a little bit longer, lost in his thoughts, almost as if he had done drifted back into another age in another place. Without fail, before he would leave, one of those seagulls would land on his old worn-out military hat that he always wore, the same one that he had been wearing for over 50 years. Finally, when he began to walk away and he would head back toward his beach home, a few other birds would hop along with him till he got to the staircase to go up into his home, and those birds would fly off, go their own way, and Ed would quietly go back home. If you were sitting there on that pier, can you imagine what your thoughts might be? Maybe you're on a pier fishing, and you look out over, and you see an old man throwing shrimp in the air, telling a bunch of birds, "Thank you." You'd probably think in your mind, "Boy, this is an odd bird," no pun intended there. Or you might even think, "Man, this guy's a little crazy. He's a few fries short of a Happy Meal." To those that would watch him on his weekly walks to the end of his pier, maybe you grow accustomed to it, but you're probably thinking, I don't know what is going on in the mind of this man. To the casual observer, his ritual probably looks extremely strange. You may think, man, he's an old man, he's doing crazy things in his old age, but you know, it's really sad because if you were to get to know this man, you'd be much richer off. You see, his full name is Eddie Reichenbacher. He's a famous war hero from World War II. During one of his flights across the Pacific, he and his seven-member crew went down, crashed into the Pacific Ocean. By the grace of God, all eight of them crawled out of that plane and climbed into the plane's life raft. Captain Reichenbacher and his crew would end up floating for days, over a month, on those wild ocean waters, facing the sun, fighting sharks, fighting other predators, but most of all, they had to fight their own hunger and their own thirst. Story goes that by the eighth day, all of their rations were gone. They had no more food. They had no more clean water to drink. They were hundreds, if not thousands, of miles away from land. Nobody knew where they were. To say that these men needed a miracle is a major understatement. Late one afternoon, Eddie says that he and his crew held a simple prayer service, and they asked God for a miracle. Then they all tried to lay down, get some peace, and take a nap. Eddie said he leaned back. He pulled down his hat, the same one that he wore on that pier feeding those seagulls. Pulled it down over his eyes to block the sun and tried to get some sleep. And he said all he could hear was the waves as they would clap on the side of that wreck. All of a sudden, he said he was awakened with something that landed on top of his head, on top of his hat. It was a seagull. Later on, Ed would tell how he sat there for what seemed like an eternity without making any moves whatsoever, trying to think of what his next move would be. He was a pilot. He was a military man. And so no doubt he had pretty good reflexes. And he said he reached up and he grabbed that bird, wrung its neck, killed the bird. He said he tore the feathers off, and he and his starving crew had somewhat of a meal that would keep them alive. They ended up using the intestines of that bird to bait and catch fish, which would give them more food and more bait, and that's how they lived until they were finally rescued. Now, that's been many, many years ago, and Eddie has passed away. But old Eddie Reichenbacher in his life said he never forgot the first sacrifice that first life-saving seagull made. He's never stopped going back to that pier saying, thank you, thank you, thank you. You know, I read that and that story, and I would agree with Dr. Swindoll, as Dr. Swindoll said, you know, old Eddie's weekly ritual is a whole lot like our yearly ritual. Every year on Easter, all across the country, people will get up early, fix themselves up, wear a new dress, wear a new tie, wear their fancy clothes, and fight a crowd for a seat on a Sunday morning in a Baptist church. Now, obviously, we're not doing that today, but the principle's still the same. I want you to think about that for a moment. Have you ever thought about how maybe odd and how unusual all of that's got to look to some people? I mean, if it's a stranger standing down at the end of the pier feeding seagull shrimp is saying thank you is strange. Think about the standard Easter service with songs like Up From the Grave He Arose. Songs like Because He Lives, Christ the Lord is risen today. Sermons with big words like salvation and resurrection and redemption and justification. Boy, that's got to be weird for some folks. For others, it's not weird. It's just worn out. It's what they've heard all of their lives. They've been getting up. They've been going since they were kids, and they've never stopped to really think about what all of it means, though. For others, it's just what we do. It's just what we do. You see, to most people, Easter's more about hiding eggs and baskets of candy and bunny rabbits and all of this than worshiping a risen Savior. But here's the problem with those of us who understand exactly what Easter really is all about. The problem with us is that many times we're guilty of assuming that everybody knows what it's all about. And so here's the big question for you and I this morning by way of some application for us. What is Easter all about? What does it mean? I mean, if we could boil it all down, if we could get to the very essence of Easter, what would its meaning be? What is the real message of Easter? I think I can sum it up with one word, and it is the word resurrection. What does the big word resurrection mean? Well, it comes from the word resurge or resurgence. It means to renew. It means to rise up. It means to come back. In other words, Jesus died. He was crucified, he was laid aside, but then he was renewed. He was raised up, he came back, he was resurrected, back to life, to never die again. And you know, that's really what sets Christianity apart from the other major religions of the world. For instance, the founder of Judaism is Abraham, but Abraham died and Abraham is still dead. The founder of Buddhism is Buddha, Buddha's dead. The founder of Islam is Muhammad. Muhammad died. Muhammad is still dead. But the founder, if you will, of Christianity is the Lord Jesus Christ. He did die. He was crucified on a Roman cross. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. The Roman government placed soldiers outside of it, put their seal on the stone to make sure that Jesus stayed dead and stayed inside. But listen to what Paul says in our text in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 20. But now, Christ is risen from the dead. Boy, that is the difference that a day makes, isn't it? You say, what difference does it make? Eternity, friend. Eternity. Listen to what Paul's argument back in verse 14 of 1 Corinthians 15. Paul says, and if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. In other words, we're wasting our time this morning. We are wasting our time. I'm wasting my time preaching. You're wasting your time listening. At least I hope you're listening. And notice he says in verse 15, yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we've testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up. If so be that the dead rise not, for if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are all men most miserable. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. The great theologian, the Apostle Paul, said, if Christ isn't risen, if Christ did not walk out of that grave, if he's still dead, we're wasting our time. We're wasting our finances. We're wasting our energy. We're wasting our faith. We are wasting everything. It's all empty. It's all pitiful. It's all void. What the great theologian Paul said. They asked Mel Gibson why his movie, The Passion of the Christ, didn't end at the cross, but ended at the empty tomb. And here's what he said. He said, without the resurrection, our faith is dead. I think the Apostle Paul, if he were there, would have said, amen, Mel. Amen. The story is not complete without the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not here this morning to debate the resurrection. That's not my case. You've probably heard all of the theories of what happened to Jesus before or after his death that people have tried to use to do their best to disprove the resurrection. I'll give you a few, some of my favorites. There's the they stole his body theory. The disciples, they say the disciples who didn't even believe that he would rise up snuck into that tomb in the middle of the night and stole his body. That's interesting to me, considering the bodyguards that the Romans put outside the tomb and the weight of the stone itself. Then there's the they went into the wrong grave theory. Again, that's a pretty interesting theory. The disciples and the soldiers and the seal of the Roman Empire, all of that, yet they went to the wrong tomb. Here's one of my favorites. I call it the they were having hallucinations theory. I tell you, they must have been on some real good stuff for the disciples and the Marys and over 500 other people to all have the same hallucination. Here's my favorite one, maybe one of the most popular ones, and it's called the swoon theory. Here's how it goes, that Jesus didn't really die on the cross, that he just passed out from exhaustion, and when he was placed in the coolness and the dampness of that tomb, that he was revived and he came back to life. I'm not even going to touch how he was able to move that stone or get out or anything like that, but let me read to you perhaps one of the greatest answers to this theory that I've ever read. In the magazine Christianity Today, there's a regular column that's kind of like the Dear Abby column. It's called Dear Eutychus. Several years ago, someone wrote a letter. Here's what they said. They said, Dear Eutychus, our pastor said on Easter Sunday that Jesus just swooned over the cross and that the disciples nursed him back to health. What do you think? Signed, Bewildered. I love the response here. They say, Dear Bewildered, I suggest that you beat your pastor repeatedly with a cat of nine tails, nail him to a cross with large nails, hang him in the sun for 6 hours, run a spear through his heart, embalm him, put him in an airless tomb for 36 hours, and see for yourself what happens. Signed, Eutychus. Listen, I'm simply saying you don't have to defend the resurrection. The resurrection defends itself. Sir Lionel Luke, who was a brilliant lawyer, as a matter of fact, the Guinness Book of World Records lists him as the most successful lawyer of all time. He won over 245 consecutive murder defenses, and so he ought to know something about evidence, he ought to know something about proof, he ought to know something about defense, and here's what he had to say about the resurrection. I say that the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ is so overwhelming that it compels acceptance by proof, which leaves absolutely no room for doubt. I think he's convinced. So I'm not here this morning to defend or debate the fact of the resurrection. The resurrection defends itself. What I want to do this morning for you and I is help us discover the force of the resurrection. You see, the resurrection is so much more than just a fact of history, even though it is that. It's so much more than just the foundation of Christianity. And though that is true and as important as that is, friend, if we don't have the resurrection, what we believe will collapse like a house of cards. But it's more than that. What I hope we're going to see this morning is that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the fundamental answer to the two greatest questions that you and I and every other single person will ever ask. Let's jump right into it this morning. Just 2 points. And if you're taking notes, we're starting right now. Here's the first thing that I want you to see. Number one, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you and I do not have to worry about life after death. We don't have to worry about life after death. Over in the book of Job, you don't have to turn there. I think it's chapter 14 and verse 14. But it asks one of the two greatest questions that you or me or anybody will ever ask. I'm paraphrasing. Here's the way Job put it. If a man dies, will he live again? Now, that's a simple question that we've all asked, I'm sure, in some way, shape, form, or fashion. Why? It's simple. Well, because there's a certain part of man that naturally fears death. And that's true. That's in all of us. That's why in the past maybe a decade or so, there have been a lot of books and maybe even some movies that have come out about death and dying, and they got real popular. Titles like Embraced by the Light, 90 Minutes in Heaven, Heaven is for Real. Listen, we all want to know what happens next. Well, you may still fear the process of dying, but if you know Jesus, you have no reason to fear death. You don't have to fear death. Because of the resurrection, death is just a shell of its former self. Our hope certainly extends way beyond this life because Jesus truly is risen from the dead. I love the way Carol Robertson put it in his book that's simply entitled The Christ. In that book, Dr. Robertson has a chapter entitled Death Destroyed Death. And in that chapter, he writes this: Jesus came to take away the fear of death. One of the wonderful benefits of knowing Jesus as the Messiah is that he takes the terrible fear of death away. We still have the natural desire to live as long as we can, but we also know that physical death is coming to all of us. But until we are ready to die, we're not ready to live for Jesus. I received an email this week. I thought it was a couple weeks ago. It was kind of funny, and I didn't realize this, but did you know that possums are really smart animals? Now, I didn't know that because the only ones I've ever seen are dead, laid upside down on the road. But there's even that joke that says, why'd the chicken cross the road? To prove to the possum that it could be done. But here's what this email said. It said that possums, as it turns out, are smart. Did you know that a possum will not enter into a hole if there's only one set of tracks going into the hole? Why? Because they know that there's something in that hole and they won't go in. But if a possum sees a set of tracks going into a hole and sees one coming out of a hole, they'll enter and they won't be afraid. Friend, that is the Easter message. That is the Easter message. You have no reason to fear death because, friend, there are tracks going into the tomb, but there are tracks coming out of the tomb. Huh. That's why the Apostle Paul preached that great proclamation of Easter in this chapter. Look in verse 54. He says, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Friend, this is the message that we need to hear this Easter morning. But now, Christ is risen from the dead. Because he's alive, you don't have to worry about life after death. The story is told of an early preacher, a missionary by the name of Paul Lyons. And Paul Lyons went to preach to the Angles who lived in northeast England. He gathered the leader of this certain area, a man named King Edwin, and his soldiers and his advisors, he preached the gospel to them. After he preached, he asked them to bow their heads, to give their heart to Christ. Well, nobody moved. King Edwin bowed his head, looked like he was in meditation, looked like he was in conviction. Finally, one of the king's trusted soldiers and one of his advisors stood and said this, "Around us lies the black land of death." Everybody agreed, and so he continued. He said, "Across the room, a sparrow darts from the open door. Within the happy firelight, one flash, and then no more. We see it come from darkness and into darkness go. So is our life, King Edwin. Alas, it is so. But if this pale Paul Lyons have somewhat more to tell, some news of whence and whither and where the soul will dwell, if out on that outer darkness the sun of hope may shine, he makes life worth living, I take his God as mine." Friend, I'm just trying to say, because of the resurrection, because of the resurrection, as a Christian, if you know Jesus as Lord and Savior, you don't have to fear life after death. Brings me to my second and my final point. And I'll simply say it this way, because of the resurrection of Jesus, not only do we not have to fear life after death, but we don't have to wonder about life before death. Before death. You see, for some of us, the scary thing isn't death, it's life. To put it more plainly, the question comes from time to time, exactly why are we here? What's our purpose? What's the purpose of life? What will we be able to leave behind? What will we accomplish? If I have a legacy, what will it be? I love how Solomon put it. Solomon said in Ecclesiastes 6:12, "For who knoweth what is good for man in this life, all the days of his vain life which he spendeth as a shadow? For who can tell a man what shall be after him under the sun?" Well, the answer to that question is in the song that I think we're going to sing in just a moment. And that is, life is worth living just because he lives. That's what the resurrection's all about, friend. That's what the resurrection means. Because Jesus is alive, you can live. You can live. Let me tell you what you have this morning as a result of the resurrection of Christ. We talk about really discovering the reality of the resurrection. Here it is. You have three things at least. Three I'll give to you right now real quickly. Number one, you have Christ's indwelling because of the resurrection. Paul said in Colossians 1:27, "Christ in you, the hope of glory." You have Christ's intercession. Hebrews 7:25, "Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them." You have Christ's involvement in your life. Jesus said in John 10:10, "I have come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." You know, so many times, we're searching for the good life. We'll spend our time and our energy and our money trying to reach the level of the good life. Friend, Jesus offers us a life that's better than good. It's better than good. Now, how in the world can we have and how in the world can we live this kind of life? Well, it's only through the involvement. It's only through the intercession. It's only through the indwelling of the living Lord Jesus Christ. One of my favorite authors, John Stott, has a wonderful little book you ought to buy. It's called Basic Christianity. He puts it as good as anyone I've ever heard or anyone ever could. He says this, "It's no good giving me a play like Hamlet or King Lear and telling me to write a play like that. Shakespeare could do it, I can't." He said, "It's no good showing me a life like the life of Jesus and then telling me to live a life like that. Jesus could, but I can't. But if the genius of Shakespeare could come and live in me, then I could write plays like that. And if the spirit of Jesus could come and live in me, then I can live a life like that. To have him as our example is not enough. We need him as our Savior." Friend, that's it. That's it. Christ came back from the dead so that we might live as he lived. So that we can live victoriously and claim the victory that he's provided. Friend, Christ didn't come to this earth and live 33 perfect years and die so that he could be oohed over and awed over and so that he could be studied in this and that. And he died and he rose again to offer through his blood and through his life new life transforming power to live beyond the worthless leftovers of a fallen world. So how can I take part in that? How do you know that I can do that? But look at the lives of his disciples, those that were closest to him. Took a coward like Peter, turned him into a rock. Took an average deacon like Stephen and turned him into the first martyr. Took doubting Thomas, turned old Thomas into a bona fide believer. I want you to look here, and I'm done. I'm done. As Brother Mark and Joni start to make their way for a time of invitation, Christianity is based upon a living person. It's based upon the resurrected Son of God, Jesus Christ. And friend, this resurrected Christ offers you this morning the power to live a transformed life. And since that's true, and it is, you ought to give your heart to him. You ought to trust him as Lord and Savior. You ought to say an everlasting yes to the Lord Jesus Christ and put your faith and put your trust in the finished work of Calvary's cross. What he did for you, his death, his burial, his resurrection. Friend, if you'll do that, friend, you can spend the rest of your life like I hope to spend the rest of my life, just like old Ed, saying thank you, thank you, thank you. Take a moment and bow your head there with your family. Hope each of you will take just a minute or so and have a word of prayer. Our musicians are on their way up for this short time of invitation. Here's my question to you. Are you saved? Do you know him as Lord and Savior, the resurrected Christ? He wants to save your soul today. Talk to your mama. Talk to your daddy. Talk to whoever you're with, your spouse. Call me. Let's get this thing settled before it's eternally too late. Brother Mark, you and Miss Joni, y'all come lead us in a verse or two of invitation.
Thank you.
was a little shy on his first song. He got warmed up. Really, really helped the music that time. And we trust that you have a tremendous Easter Sunday, worshiping with your family. And listen, if you don't have this thing settled in your heart concerning eternity, then please make that decision today. Reach out to us. We'd love to talk to you more about it. Happy Easter to all of you. Happy Resurrection Sunday. We look forward to seeing you. We miss you. We're praying for you. Reach out to us if we can help you in any way that we can. God bless you.